Those of you who weren't able to make it last week, we began a series called Priorities versus Resolutions. A lot of times we make resolutions, but in my opinion, the thing that we have to do is to figure out godly priorities. And last week we talked about the movie, The Bucket List, and in the movie, two very different men, one a wealthy businessman and the other a mechanic, they meet in a hospital room where they have both discovered that they have cancer and they only have 1 year to live. And together they come up with a bucket list of things that they want to do before they kick the bucket. They put together a list of priorities for the balance of their life. And since they only have a year left to put everything, they put everything else on hold and they head out across the world to complete their dreams and to fulfill their wish list before they die. And they do things like they go to the Taj Mahal, they visit the pyramids in Egypt, they go skydiving, they race a dream car on a raceway. And however, during their journey, as I mentioned last week, they discover that there's things that are more important in life than just completing a wish list in our life. And while the bucket list was a good idea, it didn't help them to have real priorities. It takes a while for them to start prioritizing things in life that really matter. And as I said, while it was a good idea, it didn't help them prioritize the things that really matter in a person's life. Things like faith and things like family and things like friends. Now, we're constructing a bucket list per se, and as I said last week, I gave you those little slips of paper, and I hope to engage you in the process of setting some godly priorities. And last year, we began our new year with a challenge to begin your own list of godly priorities. Now, imagine that you found out that you only had 1 year left to live. And let's say by the end of the year 2014 that you know you would meet your maker. What would be on that list? What would you accomplish before you left this earth? Now, one of the things I want to say that I didn't say last week is it's okay if in your priority list that you say that there are certain things that you'd want to see or places that you would want to go. Many of the places that we would want to see would be some of the beauty that God has created in this earth, and that would be one way that we could honor the Lord. But I'm guessing that after seeing the priorities that most of you are looking in the religious vein. What should I do? As I said, I challenge you to come up with godly priorities. And you did that. Last week, we challenged you to come up with that list. And the list of godly priorities that we are making isn't just an exercise in listing the cool things that you want to do or the things that you think that maybe the pastor would want to see on your list. Rather, your list of godly priorities is about listing the things which really matter. What really matters in your life? Well, let me read a couple of the responses from last week, and they were all over the board. One of them said they wanted to be a good church leader. So I'm assuming that is everybody who is in an office, you want to be a good church leader. We have one that says that they want to go to Scotland before they kick the bucket, and that's not a bad place. I'm hoping that when Gail and I go there someday, I don't have to wear a kilt the entire time that I'm there. Here's one: to recognize when God is speaking to me, then listen to Him and work hard to follow it through. It's a good godly priority. Here's another one: learn not to be afraid to speak of Him and stand up for Him. Here's one: make time for volunteer activities such as Meals on Wheels or Habitat for Humanity or shoveling snow when it snows at church. Actually, that wasn't in there, but I just added that. Might be a volunteer activity you'd want to do. Here's one I liked really well, and this could be any of us: be friendlier to my neighbor. So I've got one of those neighbors myself. I should have put that on my list. Here's a list of six things, and I like this list. One, refocus on God. Number two, exercise to be healthy, not just to be skinny. Everybody say, On a count of three, say all right to that one. One, two, three. All right. There you go. Start Bible study for my sister and her friends. Be a better friend. Reach out more. And here's another. Volunteer and serve more. And then the last one for today, and you'll get to see lots of these over the course of this series, is stop hiding from the world. Be more engaged. And then it says to motivate my children. Well, those are a few that we had this week, but this week we're talking about the first priority that all of us should have in our life, and that is the priority of faith. And this week we'll be looking at the bucket list priority of faith by starting with a video. Now, let me tell you that this is a video of Edward, who is played by Jack Nicholson, and Carter, and they end up having a discussion about faith while going across the polar ice cap in Edward's plane. Now, I look this way, if you will, because this screen is a little challenging for the video, but it is a little dark, but I think you'll get the gist of this. It's an amazing, I think it's an amazing 2 minutes and 15 seconds that came out of Hollywood about a discussion about faith. Let's take a look at that, if we would. Audio.
It's indescribably beautiful. Love flying over the polar cap. Love the desolation.
The stars. It's really one of God's good ones.
So you think a being of some sort did all this?
You don't?
You mean, do I believe if I look up in the sky and promise this or that, the biggie will make all this go away? No.
And 95% of the people on Earth are wrong.
If life has taught me anything, it's that 95% of the people are always wrong.
It's called faith.
I honestly envy people who have faith. I just can't get my head around it.
Maybe your head's in the way.
Carter, we've all had hundreds of these discussions, and every one of them always hits the same wall. Is there a sugar plum fairy or not? And nobody has ever gotten over that wall.
So, what do you believe?
I resist all beliefs.
No Big Bang? Random universe?
We live, we die, and the wheels on the bus go round and round.
What if you're wrong?
I'd love to be wrong. If I'm wrong, I win.
Not sure it works that way.
Well, you're not claiming you know something I don't.
I just have faith.
Sort of an interesting clip, isn't it? An interesting conversation. Having faith versus we live, we die, and the wheels on the bus go round and round. Now, if faith is irrational, or even, you know, the question is faith irrational, or even is it necessary? Because a lot of people seem to get by just fine without faith. And the movie clip we just saw begins with Carter looking out over the beauty of the polar cap, so the stars shining brightly, and his comment was, it's really one of God's good ones. It's interesting that while one man looks out the window and sees the stars and sees God's handiwork, which supports his faith, the other person just sees the same old stars he's seen 100 times, and doesn't think twice about it. It doesn't give him any reason to think that God exists, let alone to have faith and make it a priority in his life. In fact, he seems to say that faith is too much of a stretch. It's too giant of a wall to get over. The Apostle Paul didn't think it was. And he made it very clear in our passage this morning when he wrote these words. Give me my scripture. Let's go through it. It says, since what may be known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain to them, for since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. And what Paul is saying here is that God has revealed himself in creation. You know, Gary saying that, you know, look at the stars, look at the flowers in the field, and Solomon in all of his glory is not arrayed like just one little flower that many of us might call a weed growing in a field. He has made himself plain, Paul says, in his creation. And whether someone grew up in the remote jungle of South America, or where no Christian missionary had ever been, or whether you grew up in Antarctica or on Manhattan Island in New York City, the Bible tells us here that everyone is able to see creation, and in the creation can know the Creator. You know, when I look at creation, I realize that creation is so well put together. I ask questions of myself, how does a migrating bird know how to come back to the exact same spot after thousands of miles of travel? Now, that might work because, oh, maybe he has enough memory to get him there. But think about this. How does a monarch butterfly, which was born in Mexico, know how to return to the exact same territory as his parents in Michigan? When I look at creation, everything is so precise. Everything is so well designed. It reveals an intelligent designer who is smart enough and powerful enough to create everything. Everything that we see. And not only create it, but to make it work together perfectly. From the expanse of the galaxies and the solar systems down to the microscopic level that we don't even know exists until recently, like quarks. Who ever thought there'd be something called a quark? Except some kindergartner calling some other kid a quark, maybe. We are discovering new aspects of creation all the time. You know, King David picks this up in Psalm 19, verse when he says these words. He says, "The heavens tell the glory of God. The skies display his marvelous craftsmanship. Day after day they continue to speak. Night after night they make him known. They speak without a sound or a word. Their voice is silent in the skies. Yet their message has gone out to all the earth, and their works are for all the world." In recent years, the introduction of some new theories of evolution, the people have found more sophisticated arguments to explain away the need of a creator by suggesting that we really are just genetic mutations, and we are the random chance that happened over millions of years. But even in evolution, even if evolution worked, 16 billion years, the supposed age that scientists tell us is the age of the Earth, it still isn't enough time to create such complex forms as human beings. It just doesn't seem, you know, I love that part of the clip where Edward says, "I know, I just can't get my head around it," and then Carter looks at him and says, "Well, maybe your head's in the way." And when I think about what science is trying to tell me, I just can't get my head around it. Now, many of you may, then those on the other side would say, "Well, then maybe you're not getting your head around it. Maybe your head is in the way," when in reality, probably my heart is in the way. It just doesn't make sense to me. I think about this. It doesn't explain such complex relationships in something like your eye. You know, look at your eye, or look through your eye. In your eye, it would require over your eye requires over 30 different parts working together at the same time. And could somehow, simultaneously, could all of those 30 parts evolve at the exact same time? But even if we accepted macroevolution, which I personally do not, what caused what? What caused the Big Bang? Where did it all begin? Who put it into motion? No matter how great the arguments of people that people come up with, ultimately they are without excuse, as the scripture says, because the creation itself reveals a creator. Even if we have nothing else to go by, no Bible, no direct revelation, no experience of God to help his people, we have enough in God's eyes, in God's creation, to put our faith in Him. This section of verses there that Paul used in Romans, he is saying no one can say, I don't know, or I didn't realize that there was a God. There's no huge wall to jump over. It's right there in front of everyone. It is a choice we make. Some choose to walk through that door of faith, while others do not, which is once again why I love Carter's response when Edward says, I can't get my hand around it, and Carter says, maybe your head's in the way. Sometimes our knowledge can get in the way of faith in what God has plainly revealed. Now, don't get me wrong. Knowledge is a good thing. There might be a lot of folks that would hear this part of this first part of the sermon and think, "Ah, he's one of those Baptists that is against knowledge." Folks, I am not against knowledge, and let me tell you, I have a couple of degrees. I have a bachelor's degree. I have a master's degree. I've done lots of continuing education. If I didn't believe that knowledge was okay. Then there's something wrong with all the things that I've done up till this point. But knowledge can be debilitating to our faith if we allow it to be debilitating. I believe it's why Jesus said this. Give me a click. He said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. You know, even a child can get it, whereas a college professor cannot. Even if faith isn't a leap, is it really necessary? Can't we get through life just fine without it? Well, the problem is, when we reject God, what path are we left to follow? The only path, once we reject God, that we have to follow is the path that says, whatever seems right to me is my path. Listen to what Paul says about people who reject God. Take a look here. It says, they have exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshipped and served created things rather than the Creator who is forever praised. And when faith isn't a top priority in our life, or if we reject any belief in God or Jesus because it seems like Edward says, the sugar plum fairy theology, what can happen? Well, Paul's answer says people naturally begin following their own path, and they eventually begin worshiping the creation. That ultimately, when you reject faith, you will eventually start worshiping the things that God has made rather than the Creator. And the truth is, dear friends, let me tell you something about faith. Every one of us and every person who says that they are not a believer, they will worship something. We might worship ourselves, our looks, our abilities, our position, our status, our knowledge, our having all the answers, to the questions, and even more likely, our desire for self-fulfillment. You see, having a desire met, doing what I want to do, because that's what selfishness is, and it is worshiping of self. What happens in lots of other lives that reject God and reject faith is they begin worshiping another person. They become infatuated to the point that everything revolves around another person. In the movie, you discover one of the things that Edward worships is money. Edward says in the movie that he began making money at 16, and he says he never looked back. He had everything that money could buy. His life, his priorities revolved around making money. Have you ever asked someone this question, how much money is enough? And do you know the answer that you will get? By the way, I've sat across the desk as a banker from a whole lot of people asking them that specific question. You know, when they would come in and they would talk about either borrowing to do some new business to make a whole lot more money, or they had money that they needed invested in one way or another, and they would we would talk about that, and I can't begin to tell you how many people I've asked the question, how much money is enough? And the answer that I got 99% of the time was this: a little bit more. Things do not satisfy. And Edward had been, by the way, in the movie, we find out Edward had been married 3 times and didn't have any close relationship with anybody, including his own daughter. We could worship entertainment, or we worship sports. I mean, think about the people who worship sports teams. How many of you watched all 35 bowl games this year? If you did that, you might have a problem. All of these are part of God's creation and can be good for use or even to enjoy. There's nothing wrong with enjoying those things, but please make sure when you look at your life that you are not putting anything else as a top priority in your life. The place that God is rightfully meant to take. You might be able to say, so what's wrong with following our own path? Who cares if we worship something else, or at least I get what I want? Give me a click here. See, when we follow anything but God's path, we begin heading down a dangerous road. The first thing is it can lead to self-destruction. It leads to broken relationships. Marriages get destroyed, families are torn apart, addictive behaviors, inappropriate sexual behaviors. In other words, pain, anger, abusiveness, all of these results come from us choosing a path apart from God. Let me tell you, when you study in the Scriptures how God says that we're to treat our neighbors and how we're to treat the people that we love and or we say that we love, or even how we treat our enemies, you know, we can't get away from the realization that God has a wonderful plan for everyone in life. Can't begin to tell you how many times that somebody's come into my office and tried to tell me that they didn't love their spouse anymore. And then, you know, they said, I don't love him anymore. I said, well, you are commanded to love your spouse. But let me tell you, now that you don't love this person as a spouse, and they're still living in the home, that they, I guess, are now your neighbor. And you know what? God has told us to love our neighbor. And then I've had people tell me, well, I don't even think I like this person anymore. You know, they've almost become an enemy. And I look at them and said, well, you can't get out of that either, because God says, love your enemies. And what a wonderful progression throughout Scripture on how we're to deal with relationships and one another. Paul writes that God lets us do what we want, even though he knows that it will lead us down a path because of that free will. We aren't puppets, but unfortunately, it means that we experience the natural consequences of our actions. When we go our own way, God sort of lets us, you know, go ahead. Well, go ahead. Give it your best shot, and you're going to see that won't work either. It's not God's fault. It's our own fault for choosing that path. And our own path always leads to self-destruction. Secondly, when we reject God, we lose our moral compass, which may lead us down the path of doing things which are considered detestable to God. As Paul says, things which are shameful, vile, and degrading, in other words, sin. All sin to God is vile and degrading and shameful. We don't talk about it very often, but the Bible says God's anger or God's wrath, as most translations have it, is against all sin and all wickedness, which includes our own sin and our own wickedness. Romans 1:18 says these words. It says, "For the wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness." Now, folks, that's pretty strong language, isn't it? And I know we like to talk about God's love for us, which He does, but we can't forget that God gets angry over sin. Not just because He knows it harms us, but because God is holy and pure. And before we start feeling all self-righteous because of our faith in God, look at how Paul begins the next chapter when he says these words in Romans 2:1. "You, therefore, have no excuse. You who pass judgment on someone else, for at whatever point you judge another, you are condemning yourself, because you who pass judgment do the same things." Now, we had an interesting study on this particular passage this week on Wednesday morning, this is one of those verses everybody uses to say, "Oh, you can't make a judgment about me." And really, what all we're doing is pointing out the truth of God. If something is against the truth of God, it brings its own judgment, not our judgment necessarily. And Paul was trying to remind us that we've all sinned, that we can't shake our fingers at others, that we're all in the same predicament. But the final question of the day is this: is faith important? Jack Nicholson's character, Edward, says something interesting at the end of the clip. He justifies his lack of belief by saying, "If I'm wrong, I win." Now, I suppose that means that if he's wrong, and it turns out that there is a God after all, that he wins because God will somehow let him into heaven. But Carter's response, and folks, let me tell you once again, this is, to me, one of the most intriguing bits of movie-going movie in the last 20 or 25 years, is this little section about faith and how well they get it. When Carter then turns to him and he says, I don't think it works that way. Unfortunately, he doesn't elaborate on what he means by that. He didn't share what the Apostle Paul shares with us. He responded like many of us might, "Well, I just have faith." 17th century French mathematician and philosopher Blaise Pascal actually argued the opposite. Listen to what Blaise said. He said, "Belief is a wise wager. Belief is a wise wager. Granted that faith cannot be proved, what harm will come to you if you gamble on its truth and it proves false? If you gain, you gain all. If you lose nothing. Wager then without hesitation that he exists." Now, I don't think that faith is like making a wager. I think that misses the point of faith. It's not something that you do to hedge your bets. But the helpful part of what Pascal says is that if we have faith and we're wrong, you don't lose anything because you die and that's it. And the wheels on the bus go round and round. But if you are wrong, dear friends, you lose everything. And the one thing that we sometimes forget, that is, to me, it just breaks my heart when someone I know dies without the Lord, is when, if you die without the Lord, you just don't cease to exist. You will live forever in horrible torment. As good as heaven is, immeasurable, unbelievable, beyond measure, that is what hell is like for those who don't believe. Now, but if your faith is proved right, you live a better life on earth, and you live eternally with God rather than being separated from God in the other place. Paul was very explicit, dear friends, in saying that faith is the most important priority that we must have For it is because it is only faith in Christ that will be made right where we will be made right with God and be given the gift of eternal life. That's an amazing concept, dear friends. Don't miss it. And don't fail to tell those around you. And if we really believed in hell, if we really believed it was that horrible, we would tell everybody everywhere, and even if it ticked them off, we would care so much about them that we are willing to have them think that we're crazy and that we're fanatics. See, look at verses 16 and 17 of chapter 1, where Paul says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes." See that? To everyone who believes. First to the Jew, then to the Gentile. For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last. Just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. The only way we are made right with God is by faith in Christ Jesus. And dear friends, do you see why I would say that that's the first priority that we must have in our life? Is a priority of faith, trusting Jesus, trusting that He paid the eternal penalty for our sin and our waywardness by His death, that we would have life because of His resurrection. Without faith, we don't have life now, and we don't have life eternally, period. Hebrews 11:6 says these words, "And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him." You might be wondering, what does this have to do with my list of priorities? Well, I tell you, what place does faith in Jesus Christ and the living God take on your list? How will you grow in this area of your entire life when it is so important? As you create your godly priorities list, dear friends, I think this should be your top priority, the priority of faith. Will you bow with me in prayer? Father God, I thank You for the joy that I have to talk about faith in You and realize, oh God, that You are such a good God. And even though You are a good God, You have told us very clearly in Your Word that unless we believe, unless we act upon that belief, that we are destined to eternity in hell. Father, help us to realize so well in our hearts and our minds the goodness of heaven and the horribleness of hell, that we are not afraid to become the fanatic, the crazy one, so that others might be saved. Father God, this is my